Pāli Audiobooks presents Cultivating Inner Peace by Dr. Paul R. Fleischman, as read by the author.
Chapter 14. John Muir. The environments in which we, human mammals, evolved into our current form calm us like a womb. How many people have recovered from depression, renewed a dilapidated marriage, or soothed their self-esteem with walks in the woods? This is a ubiquitous discovery, requiring no doctor's suggestion, a spontaneous return home to health and the outdoors. To live a peaceful life, you have to regularly expose yourself to weather, wildlife, and the role of topography. If you think back through the preceding chapters, you'll easily recognize closeness to nature as a recurrent theme without exception in every story I've told. To fully clarify the connection between nature and inner peace, I'm going to start with the story of a great man whose life captures the effect of this free radiation treatment. John Muir, America's greatest conservationist, almost disappeared into a compulsive indoor existence until a dramatic accident forced him to rediscover the transforming power of the outdoors in service of a life of peace. Young Muir was a budding genius. Working alone, late one night by candlelight, the industrious and ambitious young man, who was busy almost to craziness, inventing machines 24 hours a day, leaned closely over his tasks. The awl in his hand slipped, and the point stabbed into his eye. Muir felt his vision dripping out into his hand. Due to the trauma in one eye and the sympathetic spasm of the other eye, his promised life seemed to close. John Muir was totally blind, closed forever on all God's beauty. Fortunately, the injury wasn't critical and had only punctured the aqueous. He lay in bed blind for a week and arose resurrected. His new goal was to learn the secret of the universe from a weed's plain heart. I might have become a millionaire, but I chose to become a tramp. He wrote on his journal his new name and address. John Muir, Earth, Planet, Universe. And he started to walk. Muir lived the rest of his life with the passionate appreciation of a man seeing the creation for the last time, all the time. Muir began the lifelong rambling, wandering, botanizing, geologizing, and writing that were to become the central activities of his life as nature's own prophet. Initially, he walked from Wisconsin to the Gulf of Mexico, wandering fearlessly through the anarchy of the post-Civil War South. And he got as far as Florida on his way to the Amazon before he was halted by malaria. He then went to California to rest and recuperate in solitude as a shepherd. Here he encountered Yosemite Valley and the Sierra Nevada Mountains and fell into one of the greatest love affairs of all time, writing prose that has been analogized to that of the Christian mystics, doing solitary scientific research that made him one of the most significant geologists of his century. And becoming a champion and spokesperson for conservation throughout the world, the guiding spirit in the creation of Yosemite National Park, as well as a founder of the Sierra Club and author of many books. Few people have poured out such sustained ecstasy in prose or have lived as appreciatively. Along with his rare mechanical, literary, poetic, and scientific intellect, Muir was an athlete of supreme, almost eerie proportions. He climbed and conquered the entire Sierra Nevadas, hugging its rocks and seams to his scrambling bosom, studying mountain glaciation more thoroughly than any person before him, squeezing through obscure canyons looking for subtle traces of moraines, and standing on top of all major peaks and divides throughout the range. Almost all of his mountaineering was done alone and without technical equipment, two things that would mark him today as far over the lunatic fringe. His mountaineering in Alaska was to be equally risk-taking and groundbreaking. From the early journals of his walk to the Gulf to the books of his late old age, Muir was a careful, popular, and successful writer. He exemplifies these aspects of the peaceful life: an unbounded sense of time and history, a sense of harmony with and community among other life forms, a modest deference to objective truth, attunement to his own body as part of nature and as a source of wisdom, a sense of love for and service to all living beings. The first striking feature of his writing is its scale. For example, the opening pages to the book, The Mountains of California, take the reader flying north and south along the entire range of light, as if riding on the back of a grand raptor. The prose leads us to see hundreds of miles of snow-capped peaks as one living backbone. At the same time, Muir portrays the shaping of the Sierras through eons of geologic history with such clarity and conviction that the reader may be induced into believing that the author had been there for the whole process. He makes you feel he watched, not deduced, the whole thing. Like Walt Whitman, Muir hovered over the earth with the attitude of cosmic accomplice. He didn't surmise nature's scope and method. He seemed to participate hand in hand. Another feature of his writing is its tone. Muir's prose is laced with extremity, like an alpinist poised to fall off the edge of the English language. In one passage, he writes of rejoicing, abundance, stupendous, spirituality, miracles, glorying, eternity, ineffability, and enchantment. This would seem forced and ingenuine if he were not able to sweep us up and waft us along in thrilling transport, enabling us to see trees as condensed sunbeams, to feel the very rocks tingling with life, and to see the sky as a vivid sunfire irradiating, luminous, like very angels of light. He helps us feel God brooding over everything, and the whole world responding in reverence as the mountains seem to kindle to a rapt religious consciousness. In Alaska, he viewed an entire mountain range at dawn, transfigured, hushed, and thoughtful, as if awaiting the coming of the Lord. At the heart of John Muir's passion about nature is one word, one insight, one mood. All chanting and blending in glorious harmony. The subtle continuous repetition of the word, harmony, is Muir's signatory state of mind. I quietly wandered away, free as a bird, independent of roads, harmonious, a bee in a garden, plain, simple relationship to cosmos. Muir made harmony his orienting point and built a lifestyle around it. He refused teaching positions at Harvard and the Boston Academy of Science, and instead cleaved to the environment he wrote about. I drifted from rock to rock, stream to stream, grove to grove. Where night found me, there I camped. When I discovered a new plant, I sat down beside it for a minute or a day to make its acquaintance and hear what it had to tell. Struggling free of even well-meant social bonds, Muir, in a manner similar to Whitman's receptive mode, stepped outside the weave of mundane entanglements. His rambles, his books, and his eco-activism all hung like objects on a mobile around a central thread. We all travel the Milky Way together, trees and men. Everything is so inseparably united as soon as we begin to describe a flower or a tree or a storm or an Indian or a chipmunk. Up jumps the whole heaven and earth and God himself in one inseparable glory. He experienced even the inorganic as melodically alive and communicative. Commenting first on lark song, he added, "Music is one of the great attributes of matter, into whatever forms it may be organized." He went on to describe the songs of water, air, and flowers. He heard the world singing to itself. Every atom in creation may be said to be acquainted with and married to every other. Muir's intimacy with nature deepened to mental states of fusion, during which he lost his sense of individual identity to blend with the whole. You bathe in these spirit beams, turning round and round, as if warming in a campfire. Presently, you lose consciousness of your own separate existence. You blend with the landscape and become part and parcel of nature. By nature, Muir always meant one mood. Harmony in everything. Harmony over and over. Muir's intuitions of the interpenetration of all lives in a synthesizing cosmic order never arrested the precision of his discriminating, probing, scientific mind. The poetic shaggy goat man who had memorized the entire New Testament Gospels as a 10-year-old child was both an altered states of consciousness mystic and a painstaking scientist. The rhapsodist who saw everything hitched to everything else was also an empiricist of detailed precision and observation. in both aspects of his personality, he subsumed himself as an obedient student to overarching truths. It is easy to misread John Muir as a romantic landscapist, when in fact his harmonious receipt from nature sprang from somatic self-observation. His realizations were based upon austere self-discipline. John's father was a former Scotch soldier who became a Protestant fundamentalist fanatic, and these two influences made him stern and tyrannical. Thrashings, deprivation of food and heat, and severe physical labor were the daily bread of John's childhood and adolescence. Although his siblings grew up normal, doctors and businessmen, teachers and homemakers, the forced asceticism of his youth was probably one influence that tempered holy wanderer Muir to tolerate so much daily hardship in adult expeditions. John Muir didn't merely endure. He thrived. His inexpressible delight in nature's secret chambers and grateful sequestration in the deep, hushed calm and peace was the fruition of living for days on a crust of bread, camping without tent and often without blankets, accepting prolonged exposure to cold, wet, and wind, not for a night, but recurrently over decades. At times, only 90 pounds of sinew were stretched on his Herculean frame. But he was not, as you might suspect based on his history of child abuse, festering in anesthetized denial of his body. Muir's unmatched mountaineering was accomplished by the dual discipline of highly attuned awareness to the subtlest proprioceptive messages, with detachment from pleasure and pain. Spontaneously, he was practicing a self-discipline similar to the Vipassana meditation I will describe in part 9. He didn't deny his body. He knew it, utilized it, and mastered it through sensitivity, not through force. He turned his body into a vehicle of awareness. He serves as an example of attunement and discipline rather than mere machismo or asceticism. I'd like to linger for a moment on one of his most compellingly told climbing exploits in order to emphasize and convey his mixture of toughness and receptivity. Muir was the first person to ascend Mount Ritter in the Sierra Nevadas, as well as many other firsts. He climbed above the tree line, alone, in his shirt sleeves, without any equipment, no rope, no ice axe, no coat, no blankets, a hard crust of bread on his belt. For an ordinary mortal, this would be simply nuts. His account of the ascent is an extraordinary literary gem by a psalmist athlete possessing demons of courage and strength, feeling the rocks beneath him, rejoicing like living creatures. He draws his readers into his own concentrated worship and hypnotic intensity. Reaching a point on the unknown rock face halfway to the top, I was suddenly brought to a dead stop with arms outspread, clinging close to the face of the rock, unable to move hand or foot either up or down. Realizing his death was certain, I became nerve-shaken for the first time since setting foot on the mountains. But in a moment, life blazed forth again with preternatural clearness. He felt possessed of a new sense. Every rift and flaw in the rock was seen as through a microscope, and my limbs moved with a positiveness and precision with which I seemed to have nothing at all to do. Had I been born aloft upon wings, my deliverance could not have been more complete. Muir ascended himself as he scaled mountains. He used his body like someone skillfully pulling taut the strings of a living guitar for it to be optimally expressive. He made his body the instrument of his spirit. For someone with a history of traumatic blindness, his expanded senses on Mount Ritter was the ultimate undoing of the past, a corrective healing. In this anecdote, we encounter not only the mountaineer and the storyteller in Muir, but also the student of self as nature. Though his example is extreme, the general point is universal and applicable. Detached observation of one's own body through all its vicissitudes leads to breakthroughs of healing clarity. This forms the basis of meditation. Exquisitely attuned to his magnificent body, yet determined to overcome pain and fear, Muir cultivated his own human nature as he absorbed the lessons of the wild outdoors. This yogic path led him, like Buddha, to see in creation incessant motion and change, eternal flux. An East Indian poet visiting the United States, on hearing about John Muir for the first time, exclaimed, "Why, he was a rishi!" Recognizing in Muir one of the legendary hermit sages of yore who wrote India's sublime scriptural literature in prehistorical eras on Himalayan forest slopes. John Muir was not all holy man. He married, ran an orchard in California, was an actively involved father and a doting grandfather, was politically engaged, a lecturer, and a counselor to Presidents Teddy Roosevelt and William Taft. Like any peace seeker, he himself sought out fellow peace seekers, and he listed his few days in the company of Ralph Waldo Emerson as one of the high points of his life. The trace John Muir left behind him is marked by a prophetic obeisance to the natural world and its creatures. He referred to animals as people and related to flowers and squirrels as fellow mortals. The peace he found in nature was animating, not sedating. It elevated his personal agony into a historical force, which gave new worldwide momentum to conservation movements. He sublimated the compassion he felt for the beaten child he was into compassion for all. And he fought his cruel father by battling progress and civilization. However, his feisty, optimistic suffusions of joy seem short of repose. A slightly rigid, repetitive, didactic insistence on exhilarated thrill and majestic sublime imply his ill ease in confronting the sorrow he was constantly hurtling over. He overcame his sorrow at the devastation of pristine nature through energetic ecstasis and practical politics. One does not find in this madcap crag conqueror mellowness, even equanimity. The harmony he sought and found in nature was a mood he cultivated to overcome psychological pain, a process we've also seen in Walt Whitman. Away from the wilderness, Muir fell sick. He needed to immerse himself in wilderness to counteract an internal ill-ease. His prose seems to spring from irrepressible emanations of temperamental ebullience, like the trail of a comet of the psychosphere, but his high spirits in adulthood couldn't be taken for granted. He had dark moods. He had ill health. Removed from nature, Muir paled. When he went exploring, he wasn't camping out. He was restoring himself through worship. His divine fire required constant stoking with mountains and skies. Muir claimed he was always happy at the center, and while this was probably an extension of the truth, he could always find optimism and energy by recontacting nature. "Religion," he said, "is on all the rocks." Despite his garrulous and wide-ranging affability, a painful split separated Muir from humankind. His writing pits pristine divine wilderness against destructive, ignorant humans. He fails to search for the womb where the human monster itself emerged from his goddess nature. He couldn't assimilate the fact that the dark forces he fought were not outside of nature, but part of the world evolving, just like his beloved creative destructive glaciers. In glaciation, but not in civilization, he could see that what we in our faithless ignorance and fear call destruction is creation. For all his cosmic imagery, Muir remains one of the supreme scientist poets of the surface of the world. His pagan worship of storm and pine made him the earth's high priest. But he wasn't anchored in the inner light. He couldn't find harmony apart from rambunctious muscularity. The essential love overlying, underlying, pervading all things that he found in wilderness, he couldn't find in the trammeled 20th century world. We feel in Muir not quite a patriarch, but the most magnificent boy of all. He inspires us to dare, to strive, to ascend, to temper our edges and to nuzzle with camaraderie, warmed and quickened into sympathy with everything. Several aspects of John Muir's biography deserve emphasis. Young Muir, having grown up in a world of seemingly endless Wisconsin wilderness, could follow the call of an indoor fortune because he fantasized that he and nature had some unimpeachable future tryst. The dramatic blindness was like a divine herald, a reminder of life's transiency, a call to activate his real purpose. The rest of his life was counter-inspired by a sense of nature's fragility. The sight of every tree and rock he now understood as an ephemeral gift. His experience reveals that emphasis on the transiency of our good fortune isn't depressing, but heightens our continuity of appreciation. Muir's love of living was boundless. Wood rats were innocent, fine companions. Lizards were small fellow mortals, gentle and guileless, They are easily tamed and have beautiful eyes, expressing the clearest innocence, and they will teach you that scales may cover as fine a nature as hair or feathers or anything tailored. John Muir made himself a flake of transparent glass, through which humankind would be brought to new truths. I care to live only to entice people to look at nature's loveliness. The peaceful person is always a conduit rather than a vault. Muir built no walls between science and literature, science and religion, religion and politics, prose and poetry. He lived in a complex whole. The thread connecting his diversity of inspiration and talent was a freshet of harmony that flowed through him from his contact with nature. The depth of his inspiration enabled him to infuse many aspects of a whole vision without feeling fragmented. John Muir's story echoes aspects of the peaceful life that are not limited to his harmony-oriented, self-reflective, time-opening, caretaking love of nature. He returned from distress to peace in dynamic self-reminding, and he practiced selectivity to an extreme. He was fundamentally not a writer, scientist, or conservationist, but an ebullient emissary between humans and the whole he communed with in nature. Like a Scotch druid reborn for a cause, he was carried to the New World by his father, then swept on to California to speak for the trees. Getting rained on is part of the way we are born to be. Muir heard with trumpet and timpani what the rest of us also hear, but in whispers. The self-diminishing, self-confirming beauty and love that radiates from unadorned nature. On every walk in our own neighborhoods, there is a Mount Ritter moment when our blindness is lifted.